Good afternoon, everybody. Hope you have a nice time at the end of the day. I'm not from any company. I'm a PhD candidate here at JTU. And I'm going to present my experience working for RISC-V since 2014, right after it was published first time. And I started using both as in the company I used to work and also in my research from the previous university in Brazil. We'll talk about some introductions and my experience working with this company. As I said, I'm from Brazil, I'm also from China, but I'm from SJTU, and from the city. I had to make the credits for my previous university. All this work was done before coming here to China, so I have to give my credits for my former university and my former employee, the Center for Strategic Technology at the Northeast. So using, as I was working there, working on the design house there, so we had a problem. The clients come to us and ask us to do a design for them to use in their product. So our problem was to fit some blocks of IP together under a specific price point, so we couldn't design a really expensive product for them, so we had a really constrained price point. And as it's for third parties, it should be easy to use and to maintain because we're going to design and give them today all the RTL, the code, the software, and they're going to maintain, so it should be easy for them to keep it. So it's simple, but it's a big problem. And our expertise was on designing all the IP cores, but in the end, we had the problem of needing a CPU to do all together and make it work. So we decided for designing our own CPU core and why. First, economics. For anyone that's doing research, usually we have at the lab the big FPGA boards that cost thousands of dollars, but in the end, to deliver to a client, we have to make it fit in a really small FPGA so they can sell it. So we couldn't design a really big CPU, otherwise it wouldn't be profitable for them. Second, it's only the IP. As a design house, we need IP to provide to customers. And our options were NIOS, so we have to pay Altera and Intel for licensing royalties. We could license ARM core, or we could design OpenRISC or use our homebrew 8051 core. But it's 2014 at the time, so using an 8051 core in 2014 doesn't seem to be the best option. So yeah, they do matter. People say the instructor said don't matter, but they do matter. And the third reason is personal, is being a recently graduate, if I had the opportunity to design a CPU core and I'm going to pay for it, I'm going to do it. If I'm not going to pay, I don't understand. That's what you said. So in August of 2014, I saw this article. We are going with OpenRISC, designing our own OpenRISC CPU there. But that was I saw this article three times, as usual. And RISC-V gives us a 131-page specification, stable tools. We can make our own implementation, open source, efficient. And at the beginning, was no community, but now we have an open, active community. So these are all points to RISC-V. So we decided to go with RISC-V instead of designing our own open RISC. So yeah, the pros of designing from the specification is we have complete freedom, which is good. But we can do incremental development. We can do the instructions that we need first, and then doing the extensions. And we can go to the make a design that fits the target FPGA we're going to deliver. So we have complete freedom to do that. But also have some down points. At the time, we need a bus, peripherals, OS, software, and drivers to make it work. And at the time, August 2014, there was none of it. So we had to make our own infrastructure for Tanaka, which we did. We designed it first, we call it Oolong. I used to drink a lot of Oolong tea. And we need an integer and multiplication extension targeting less than 5,000 logic elements for hotel FPGA. We focus on I/O, so we have to deliver GPIO, UART, SPI, all the protocols, and interfacing for analog digital converters and digital analog converters. And since we focus on simple access to peripherals, we don't have much memory, so the driver is really simple. And we decided to use Wishbone Bus, which gives you 2 to 3 clock cycles access. And the drivers were really small and fit the limited FPGA that we have. So that's what we went with. And the main core has a 3-stage pipeline and on machine mode, static point prediction, and use 3 memories, one for the bootloader, one for the program, and another one for the interrupts for 2 timers and all of the peripherals that we interrupt the CPU. And we wanted a 1.36 megahertz. We're using the multipliers from the FPGA, so as we are going to our FPGA call, why not use the multipliers? But also develop an extension for software-defined radio, since we were working with some radio protocols, like RFID and others. So we had the IP call running on the FPGA, but we also, what if the client wants to change in the future and to make this possibility of using software to upgrade? We developed some instructions for complex number arithmetic to do parameter modulation and multiply accumulate. And also for Galois field GF2 multiplication for slightly faster, 32% faster decryption on AES. And also, since we are doing software-defined radio, we have to process voice a lot of characters, so also some assign the 8-bit instruction. So, since we are working with 32 bits for RISC-V, but complex numbers has a real and an imaginary part, we divided in half, so 16-bit each. So it seems weird, but most ADCs and DACs, they work with less than 16 bits, so we still had 16 dB of dynamic range in the end, so it's okay for us. So the instructions that is, they have complex addition, subtraction, conjugate, multiply, absolute value, all the complex number arithmetic. And the PX mode is for multiplying the field. And some vector instructions for 8-bit compression. Why do a complex multiplication? Because it takes 8 instructions to do one complex multiply. So reducing code size and speed, so it seems viable to do it. With this, we got a 20% faster modem. Considering all the other processing of the modem, the per characters, computers, so with this multiply, we get 20% faster, which is the difference of being able to run the modem on the FPGA or not. So 20% makes a lot of difference. And we also developed all the peripherals for it, GPIO, SPI, also a numeric control oscillator for generating the RF frequencies, up converter, down converter, all the disintegrated of the response for. And I model that, but we're still developing new codes for using RISC-V as a platform for developing content. And I came here to SJTU and it's a clean slate, but we're still using, we plan to still use RISC-V, but focusing on accelerated design from the lab here in this building, 10 steps from here. So we're focusing on neural networks, computer vision, SLAM. And we are going to use RISC-V as a hub for all of these accelerators and all this research, which also involves programming language, how do I want to integrate with these accelerators, how I'm going to interface with them. So more instruction set allows us to do this, and So we're going again in this five as the main hub for our research here. That's it. I want to do a poster here, so I'm already giving some information for the poster, so any questions you can answer them.
Hi, four. How many students were working on the project?
Me and another sample guy.
Oh, wow. How long did you work on this?
This was my master's program, and you?
Oh. So, so the modem worked?
Yeah.
Oh, cool. Are you planning to open source your peripherals and accelerators?
I have to talk with my former advisor, my employer, but probably. Some of them I guess I could do it, but not know, all of it I don't know. But some of them, yeah.
Cool.
Hi, Sean from India. I'm not a modern guy, so maybe my question a little stupid. So, what's criteria to decide whether to go with a ISO extension or to go with a peripheral accelerator?
We already have the accelerator, but if you want to make a change in the, since it's radio, if you want to make a change in the field, you have to change the ITL, so group program the FPGA. So you can have some functions on instructions, you can just change the protocol or the frequency or something. It would be easier to maintain.
Hi, Hope. This is Paul from National Taiwan University. So how do you decide that you want to do an instruction extension for imaginary number? I know that you find out that the multiplication needs 8 cycles, but when you have a program, how do you narrow it down and find out that this is a target?
We did profiling of the code using standard with 5 instructions. And doing profiling of the assembly code and reading, we could find that at that point we could get it faster by using an instruction. And also because the hardware does the same kind of operation by doing IPL. So we already knew more or less what to do. And doing code profiling, we could find out what to make an instruction and what not to make an instruction.